Northeastern in 2010 after teaching at Cal State Hayward. So her research focuses on early modern science and print culture. And her first book was called The Book, The Life Story of Technology. It was published in 2005 and is now paperback with Johns Hopkins. She's published articles on technology and culture in many other scholarly journals, and her current work is called Loath to Print, The Reluctance of the Scientific Author, 1500 to 1750, which is under contract with Johns Hopkins. And this talk today is part of that project called Exposed to the Lazy Ignorant, Medical Authority in Print Culture. And we have some books that you'll be talking about today that are on display. You're welcome to come up afterwards and look at them, but we do ask that you do not have food or drink when you look at these books. Some of them are free. So thanks, Nicole. As she mentioned, I'm working on a book right now called Loath to Print, and I started this about a year ago. And the idea is that as I studied scientific authors from the 16th and 17th century, there seemed to be a reluctance on their part to put their work into print. You would think that they would love it, that the printing press gave them a technology that would allow them to put their ideas out there in great number. But in point of fact, a lot of them didn't like it at all. And they resisted it for several reasons. They didn't like having to hassle with printers. Maybe they didn't like to deal with readers who weren't equipped to read their work. So the book that I'm writing explores this reluctance. Some of them just refused to publish at all. There's a mathematician named Vermont who just stopped publishing work. Actually didn't really start. He said, I can't be bothered. I'll just send my work to mathematicians and they can tell me what they think. So I was working on this, and for this talk, decided to shift into medicine, and I was a little bit struck and then a little bit caught up because I was finding the exact opposite in medicine that I found in almost every other field of science, which is that they were not reluctant to print at all. And looking at London in the 16th and 17th century, I found the eagerness to print overwhelming. There's so much printed material. So in a way, this has been really useful for me because it sort of turned my thinking on its head in terms of my larger project and forced me to contend with it. But it also has allowed me to focus on a particular case study that I'll talk about here today. So I'll start with a short anecdote. In 1698, a fellow named Thomas Mace published a book in quarto entitled Riddles, Marvels, and Rarities, A New Way of Health from an Old Man's Experience. Over 17 pages, Mace described his primary qualification for dispensing medical information. He had lived almost 80 years. And he offered his readers the secrets for good health. Chief among them was priest's powder, available for purchase. Mace's work is an empiric's advertisement, however much he didn't like that label. He said, quote, it was never my business to play the quack or the empiric. But then he goes on to promise that one dose of his medicine will keep you well your entire life. Mace's publication is totally typical for early modern London, when the medical marketplace was flooded with broadsides and pamphlets advertising the latest with pills, salves, powders, balsams. These frequently came from unlicensed physicians who parlayed their experience as community or itinerant healers into market publications. And there was a market, we know this. 17th century England was host to 200 printers and booksellers of medical works. And booksellers were financing and disseminating popular health manuals to a new audience eager for the material. There's no way they would have printed as much stuff as they did. In just two decades, if we just look at 1640 to 1660, there were 207 medical works published in England, published in English, compared to only 30 in Latin. So that just tells us how exponentially great the number had become of works targeted toward a much bigger audience. Thomas Mace then is in good company. At the other end of the spectrum were works like Jonathan Goddard's Discourse, setting forth the unhappy condition practice of physic in London. You get used to the fact that the titles for these books are not real. Published in 1670 with the full weight of the Royal College Goddard hoped to undeceive the vulgar with his text and to reassert the authority of the college. The printing press was, for men like Goddard, the undoing of medical authority, vexing the vulgar in ways both dangerous and unethical. The backdrop to both Goddard's and Mace's work is the complicated tangle of medical authority in early modern England. 17th century London was home to hundreds of medically trained individuals who practiced as surgeons, apothecaries, and physicians. But the presence of these so-called irregulars, that was the term that we used for them, they're not licensed, it's not legal for them to practice, but they do. So the presence of these irregulars was in direct violation of the statutes of the Royal College of Physicians, the body that governed licensing. And the college had little interest in seeing their practices legitimized. Christopher Merritt, who was an important member of the college, and he wrote once, "Vulgus vult decepi, the vulgar will needs be cheated." Merritt and other propagandists for the college worked tirelessly to ensure that unlicensed physicians were lumped together with actual charlatans, all of whom, he said, were preying on the poor and the ignorant. The college's view lacked nuance, for obvious reasons, but in practice, there was a robust middle ground between the poles of the fellows and the frauds. And I think of it as sort of a medical equator where the authority of practitioners was asserted and assailed with great frequency. And I'm interested in this middle ground, right, between these two poles. And specifically in the way print was used to provide medical practitioners with solid footing, a legitimacy that they could parlay into enhanced practice or increased sales. I mean that as sales of books or sales of medicines. I don't approach this in terms of the medical marketplace, which is a historical approach that tends to privilege economic aspects of healthcare consumerism, but rather from a social and bibliographic perspective. While earning a living was obviously important, being prevented from doing so by the College of Physicians was a serious blow to a practitioner. I'm not really trying to understand the success or failure of irregular positions in economic terms. I'm interested in how print assisted them in their quest for validation. So to explore this question, I did two things. The first was sort of abstract and tried to give me a picture of what I was doing, and then the second I narrowed in. So I started by looking at records from the English short title catalog. And some of you are familiar with that. It's a giant database of books printed in English. Enormous. And I narrowed my search to 15 to 1700 and looked at books related to physic, which is what they call medicine, right? Or medicine. That pulled for me a set of 531 medical treatises that I could then look at. And because I can't actually manageably look at 531 medical treatises, I tried to find something they all had in common, and this is something I've been interested in before. And this is the preface to the reader. This is in almost every one of the books I looked at. So for those unfamiliar, works at this time, it doesn't mean medicine, it could be law, it could be theology, philosophy. They almost always have this part of the book, right? You have title page, frontispiece, you have usually a dedication, comes next, really common, and then a preface to the reader. 85% of the medical ones I looked at had such a preface. So that put me from 531 down to about 450. And I read it. And my family listened to me read them. And they're very interested. In most cases, these prefaces are written by the author. And I think they're important. They're easy to overlook. Historians sometimes treat their contents as really tedious, you know, rhetorical templates. And they do have a pretty consistent set of characteristics. 300-400 of them, and a lot of the same themes come up again and again. But they matter because they're the closest thing we have to direct speech between the author and the author's intended audience. So they can provide really useful insight. They were carefully crafted to frame a work for readers. They often describe their intended audience in very explicit terms. I'm writing for you, and I'm not writing for you. Really, really detailed. Some of them will tell you how you should read their book. They'll say things like, read my book through without a pen in hand. Then, go pick up a pen and read through a second time. By the fourth time, if you don't understand my book, you should put my book down. Because there will be Rather, the refrain of these prefaces is that medicine should be accessible to the vulgar. Term that is not as pejorative as men think, right? It's okay that they say that. So a few examples. There's a guy named Nathaniel Lomax. He tells his readers that he, quote, aims to be as active in undeceiving the world as the empirics have been in deluding it. In her book on domestic medicine, Hannah Woolley argued for the utility of her work, since most other treatments of the topic, quote, are confounding rather than instructive. And Thomas Law, in his preface to Physic for the Poor, explained that his work made medical practice accessible to those of little means. He claimed to offer, quote, a complete method of physic, so plain, so easy, capacities maintained. It is an injustice, he said, that those who cannot read Latin are deprived of important medical information, not to mention the inability of many to afford the expensive medicines that are recommended. This kind of preparatory posturing clearly challenged the authority of the College of Physicians and the top-down production of illicit medicine. There's a populist tone in prefaces like eschewing complexity and scholarly trappings for practical, do-a-lot-of-it-yourself home physic. But there's something else going on in these prefaces that's interesting. Irregular physicians began to shift the definition of charlatanism. So we're talking about physicians who are truly quacks, who are harmful, who are dangerous. And what they want to do is make that less clear or more clear, depending on how you look at it. So rather than defending themselves against the characterization that they were the quacks or empirics, or denying that empirics are even harmful, the irregulars openly complained about the problem. Everywhere, they said, people are being treated by individuals who don't know what they're doing. To make matters worse, these imposters to medicine were not necessarily street physicians or pill hawkers. Those you could pick out, they would say. You can tell. It's clearly But sometimes they're educated and licensed practitioners who, despite the college's stamp of approval, know little of what they speak. The irregulars then sought to redefine medical competence and use print to do this. A 1675 treatise by a guy named Thomas Cook warns readers of the co-equal dangers: charlatans selling unsafe cures, and the college, which puts people in the position of wanting to purchase those cures because affordable help is not available. John Colbatch in Apothecary tells his readers that while he expects carpers, and carpers is pretty much code word for collegiate physicians, right, the top-down guys. He expects carpers, but his design is simply to undeceive people. He addresses the rift between college physicians and apothecaries, which he says needs mending, lest quacks come in and take advantage. Quote, common people who are not judges aren't easily imposed on. Abraham Miles begins a popular work of physic by assailing learned physicians who keep the knowledge to themselves, locked up, as it were. They are the mouthpieces, he says, not the doctors who publish accessible cures. Another physician assures the reader that his desire is not to break down your banks, let in a flood of empirics upon you, but to give you recourse when you cannot access a licensed practitioner. Treatise after treatise after treatise warns readers against the reckless empirics and the Royal College. Print allowed the very definition of charlatans to be reimagined, and no unlicensed practitioner did this better than a guy named William Salmon, who I'm going to talk about a little bit now. Salmon was born in 1644, and we know remarkably little about his early life. I wish we could find out more. There are a lot of Salmons in London at this time, some of them even two of them members of the Royal College of Physicians. He's not related to them, so it's a common enough name. This guy, as a young man, attached himself to an empiric, a practitioner of medicine, and he described him only as a medley, quote, part author, part bookseller, one that published and sold his own works. So the only thing we have from Salmon about this guy is sort of study under is that he wrote and published his own books. This individual also created and sold medicines, and we know he traveled by taking salmon with him to the West Indies, maybe farther, maybe North America, it's a little bit unclear. By 1671, Salmon was back in London, patients who had been denied care at the facility. So this isn't an uncommon thing to do if you're in a regular position. You just pitch a tent right outside the place where people won't be able to get in, and when they can't get care at the hospital, they'll come to you. Like many unlicensed physicians, he had a hand in all aspects of medicine. He did anatomy, chemical medicine, astrological physics, and even surgery. Of course, he practices outside the purview of the college, unlicensed but not unusual. In addition to seeing patients, Sam developed, marketed, and sold his own line of medicines, claiming that his, quote, wonderful pills were the most powerful cathartic in the world. His cordial pill, as he called it, was the greatest and most excellent preparation of all the opiates yet invented. Coupled with his drops and balsam, Sam claimed that he was providing families with affordable and efficacious care. He even had a mail order business, offering to post medicines to anyone in the kingdom who sent for them. I'm kind of interested in this. If anyone's heard of mail order medicine, I don't know if you have any, but I'm following up on it later. If it comes up in any of your work, I would love to hear about it. It's the earliest instance of that I've ever seen. What makes Sam an exemplary to me is not that he sets up shop outside a hospital, though. It's his savvy use of the press to develop all aspects of his practice. In a 43-year career, he published over 50 works and had them sold in dozens of bookstores throughout London. Through careful composition, the way his books were organized and sourced, and the way they appeared, and wide distribution, Salmon was able to erect a professional public image. So I want to look now a little bit at how he did it. Imagine if you want to become legitimate, what do you do? So, step one, publish a general work of physic. He does this in 1671, the same year he sets up his practice. He published Synopsis Medicinae, compendium of astrological, galenical, and chemical medicine in 3 volumes. It's printed in octavo. So, if you're not familiar with book types, I'll just take the last page of my talk and show you. A single sheet is folio, right? You can just print on a single sheet. If I fold this sheet in half, it could be like that. That's folio. So imagine a much bigger sheet. You can fold it twice and get quarto. You can fold it again and cut the pages. And so it goes folio. Quarto is smaller, octavo is smaller, duodecimo is smaller yet. They're teeny tiny little books like pocket books, right? So he has this published in octavo, and that's usually a signal that an author's making something useful and accessible. It won't be that expensive. It's not always the case, but it's generally the case. It was sold for 3 shillings 7 pence. Shop of Richard Jones, a bookseller at the Golden Lion in Little Britain. This is a neighborhood in London. That part of London was described by one contemporary as follows. It's a plentiful and perpetual emporium of learned authors. And men went thither as to a market. The shops were spacious, and the learned gladly resorted to them, where they seldom failed to meet with agreeable conversation, and the booksellers themselves were knowing and conversable men. Salmon then had chosen a printing hotspot for his initial publication, and his work was well priced. At under 4 shillings, the Synopsis Medicinae was slightly cheaper than an evening at Blackfriars to enjoy the theater. So it gives you a sense for what's accessible. The work is eclectic in content, it's prolix in presentation, it's 432 pages. He was not a man of few words. It covered tremendous medical ground. In the preparatory epistle, he touts the work's accessibility, arguing that obscurity just hinders public health. And he describes each of the 3 books that constitute the whole, diagnostics, prognostics, and therapeutics. For Salmon, each of these had both a physical and an astral component. And one of the reasons he was criticized at the time is because of this, retaining this tyrannical, this astrological piece to his medicine. A lot of physicians have left that behind. He had not. He maintains that nobody had yet braided together the threads of chemical, herbal, uranical, and classical medicine together in such an accessible way. He says, or make myself become very useful to the learned, yet I may sufficiently satisfy the curiosity of the ignorant. We don't know how many copies of this book sold. That's difficult to get at, but a second expanded edition of over 1,200 pages was published in 1681, and that edition was reissued in 85, 95, and 99. Suffice to say, his first foray into print was pretty successful. This is the same picture of him, just a little bit better copy, and I thought it was interesting just to point out, you see his form in years, but if you would, view his just soul, which crazy, no, which as crazy can't be bold, into his work and following track that look, the lively picture of his mind, the lively picture of his mind, the book. So he's really equating his own head to a book. I think an interesting choice for him. So step two on your march toward legitimacy, publish about the drugs. Once he'd done a work of medical theory and practice, Salmon turned his attention to pharmacology, a move which put him in tangential conflict with the College of Physicians. This was a little bit more aggressive. The first book's pretty innocuous. In 1678, his English translation of the Pharmacopoeia Londinensis was published by Thomas Docks. Docks is a famous printer at the time. Subtitled The New London Dispensary, it was brazenly dedicated to the There was a time when you never would have done that. It would have violated all kinds of protocol to just give your dedication to the king. But in this context, it doesn't matter anymore. He just does it. And Salmon said in his preface, he had translated the book for public good. Its publication was an overt challenge to the college's authority to regulate drugs and apothecaries. And it was only the second English translation made available in London, the first being done by Nicholas Culpepper. We actually have that. This is the first English translation of the Pharmacopoeia. For those who aren't as familiar, this is basically the Bible of drugs. And it was put out by the Apothecaries Guild, but carefully monitored by the College of Physicians. They wanted to know what was in it, and there was a fraught relationship there. So this came out by Culpepper. The College of Physicians hated Culpepper. With a white heat, they disliked this man. That book went through several editions and multiple reissues, and you can come look at it after. It's interesting to look at what sort of a Merck drug manual looks like in the 17th century. So that's effectively what Salmon's doing here. His translation targeted lay readers with its clarity, its portability, again, it's in octavo, and its affordability. Its content was also expanded beyond what the college offered. With preparations described in both traditional and Paracelsian terms. So he's using medical ideas, chemical medical ideas that are newer. Salmon claimed he offered the public remedies that were kept hidden by the college, hitting the note of secrecy that many before him had played. In the preface to the reader, he directly criticized the college for keeping its pharmacopoeia out of the reach of those who needed it. But he didn't limit his criticism to the elites. Toward the end of the preface, with the added highlight of a manicule, you know manicules, like the little pointy finger? It's common in this period. He puts his manicule down and he starts unloading on, quote, an impudent and illiterate quacksalver, who had gone around London purporting to treat people, but causing harm instead. Worse, this person claimed on the occasion the name William Salmon. The identity fraud left the real Dr. Salmon undone. Salmon chastised the imposter, as well as all misguided charlatans, and adamantly argued for his place among legitimate, honest physicians. Pharmacopoeia was printed by Docs and available, according to Salmon, at booksellers across the city. That down below there. These booksellers included Thomas Bassett, John Wright, and Richard Chiswell, all of whom advertised the work. Bassett's shop was reputable. He was known for his catalog of law and history, and for also having published the work of anatomist Thomas Willis. He's done some readings. He offered Salmon's pharmacopoeia bound for 7 shillings at the time of the press. Richard Chiswell was even better known, having published over 1,000 books in the 17th century. His father-in-law had been bookseller to the king, and Chiswell himself became a printer to the Royal Society and was considered one of the great scientific publishers of the day. Salmon had therefore taken one of the most important medical works of the period, Pharmacopoeia, translated it into English, and had it sold in the most popular bookstores in London for scientific and medical publications. It would reappear in over 7 editions throughout Salmon's career, continually printed by docs and sold in an increasing number of shops. Salmon is staking out ground with his practice. Step 3, keep them coming back for more. Iatrica, the practice of curing, was Salmon's next major foray into medical publishing. Its publication strategy was Salmon's most creative, and I think it's fascinating. Described on the title page as a work, quote, of singular use to all practitioners of the art of physic and surgery, whether physicians, surgeons, apothecaries, or charitable as well-disposed gentlemen and ladies. The Iatrica was to be a massive compendium of medicines. Salmon estimates in the preface to the reader that the entire thing would be 500 to 600 pages and take years to complete. Given that, Salmon decided to release pages of his Iatrica as they came off the press. He writes, quote, for the present satisfaction of the buyer, a continual supply will be provided to the carrying on of this so great a work, which, were it to be exposed whole, would scarcely be sold under £4 a book. The first sheet will begin on Wednesday, the 27th of July, 1681, and come out weekly, Wednesdays and Fridays, till the sum of all the said cures are exposed. Salmon notes that each sheet or set of sheets released would treat a particular disease, and that the sheets could be collected into groups that would ultimately form 5 books. The first section, if you look at it, deals with diseases of the head, and the whole thing ended up being completed 400 and some odd pages later with a theory of apoplexy. The work was originally printed in quarto, again for docs, the printer to the king, and for Langley Curtis, a bookseller at Ludgate Hill. Copies were also sold by Thomas Passenger and the 3 Bibles at London Bridge. I think it's completely inventive on Salmon's part to purport to be publishing a book that would be too big and so heavy, so expensive. So what you do instead is you have people go to the printers twice a week and pick up what is printing a medical book in serial. I've never heard of anybody else doing this. Talk about getting them on the hook. It's a clever idea, I think. I also would be very interested in having done this and doing a census of this book to see how the books were put together. I mean, somebody who goes and buys the first month's worth of pages, keep buying. If you have psoriasis, you stop buying when you get to pee and never go back. There's some interesting stuff going on here. So he follows this book with something called the Family Dictionary. I won't spend too much time on this. It's an alphabetical list of domestic medicines. But his preface is worth noting. He says in his book, here you may repair to an asylum and find the arcana open for your good, which have been hitherto locked up in the greater part of mankind. All difficulties and hard terms or words have been removed, which have puzzled ingenious persons, and the path is made so smooth that any reasonable capacity or understanding may travel it without the least fear of stumbling or falling into error. And that's another 400-page work that goes from A to Z and you would use in a home. It even includes things like recipes. At some point, it launches off into, you know, efficacious marmalades and things like that. The kind of thing that will give you vigor. So far, then, we've seen Salmon publish general and accessible work of physic, comprehensive pharmacopoeia, his specialized stuff. He ended up doing a work on surgery. Gloss over here. He did a work on anatomy, the art of anatomy. And the next 2 decades, the 80s and 90s, have Salmon publishing more than a dozen works from familiar and new publishers. He even had hand in medical translation. In 1686, he translated Johann de Laus's Systema Medicinale into a portable volume for the public good, he says. In 1694, he translates the work of Dutch physician and anatomist Niebuhr, The Anatomy of Human Bodies. His most popular translation, though, was that of Thomas Sydenham, Obsessus Integri, the Practice of Physic. This book's published in 1695 by the people who were printers to the Royal Society. And Salmon's translation included considerable annotation and editing. He expands a whole lot on what Thomas Sydenham originally wrote. That Salmon found a kindred spirit in Sydenham should not surprise us. Now, today, Thomas Sydenham is referred to often as English Hippocrates. He's got a lot of standing. He was liked at the time, but he operated outside the medical mainstream in some ways. Sydenham had a medical practice for 13 years before he had an MD. And though he was licensed by the College of Physicians in 1663, he never applied to become a fellow. He called for reform of medicine, and he believed that medical interventions were not always good or necessary, something Salmon kept saying over and over, you don't always have to intervene. The translation was for Salmon a project clearly aligned with philosophical interests, but also marketability. Salmon noted that a Latin edition of Sydenham had sold more than 7,000 copies in 3 impressions. So a translation was going to sell, and he has a real sort of ear for the market. And it did. This went through 3 editions. It also aligned Salmon in a new way with mainstream medicine in London. College physicians thought very highly of Sydenham. So if Salmon could position himself in proximity to the new English Hippocrates, he could only benefit. One of Salmon's originals. And I won't read it, or I'll turn every page, but this is his 1710 William Salmon published in Herbal. And it's called the Botanologia, or the English Herbal. It's a history of plants. These are the kinds of things we're not uncommon with the way that different plants can be used as medicines. It has a very beautiful kind of elaborate frontispiece. Anyone here is a historian of talk to me about why Solomon and Cyrus are on the frontispiece. I would like to learn more about that. This is also the size of this book is obviously has some grandeur to it. This would be expensive. The title pages are black and red, which is a little bit more costly. So this isn't a cheap book, probably, but you want to print out and have people pack around. This is a nice book. It's extremely popular. Known as the dispensary controversy, which is as exciting as it sounds. At its root was a debate between the College of Physicians and the Apothecaries Guild, which is why Sam's title page indicates that he's writing this on behalf of apothecaries and surgeons. By printing it, Sam had entered a very public quarrel between the college that had major implications for his status as a legitimate practitioner. This book will get him sued by the college. They'll fight a lawsuit on the grounds that a corporate entity can't sue an individual, so then the president of the college has to say, okay, well, I'm suing you, and it leads to some strange case law. It's also the subject of a satire, if you're interested, by Samuel Garth. There's a poem called The Dispensary. So to understand Salmon's rebuke, we have to start with the college's publication, The State of Physic in London. The lengthy subtitle for this references the college's plan to start offering free medical advice for the poor. They were basically going to set up office hours and let people come get medical care for free. They start by talking in a sort of magnanimous tone about the history of the Royal College and the Acts of Parliament that gave them authority to punish illegal practitioners, then talks about making the Apothecaries Guild, that was 1617, and highlights some problems that subsequently emerged. The biggest problem they have is that they think there are too many apothecaries. The college claims there are over 800. Seems to be a bit hyperbolic, but it's their panel. London surgeons fared no better, of course. They came under fire for abuses and fatal mistakes. After a dozen pages disparaging the ethics of these practitioners, the college pledges to publish a list of cheats and imposters who swarm about the kingdom to the visible destruction of thousands of our fellow subjects. The pamphlet's unsigned, though its origin at the college is clear, and it came from the press of a very interesting woman named Elizabeth Whitlock. She's got her hand in all kinds of religious and political debates. She also lived, her shop was next door to the Barber Surgeons Guild, so she wrote a treatise on behalf of the barber surgeons. So she publishes The State of Physic. Sam responds to it with this, also published by Elizabeth Whitlock. So that's a pretty good move to go to the publisher of the original text, have yours published. And his rhetoric here is predictable. He calls the college's pamphlet, quote, a fardel or bundle of lies containing scarcely one grain of honesty. He takes up the claims of the college, point by point, quoting their text in italic. He basically quotes the whole pamphlet in response to each piece. Quote, two or three lines, response, quote, response, all the way through. At one point, he looks at the college's proposal that they make medicines available for the poor at their, quote, intrinsic value, which meant at cost, not profit. Salmon scoffs at this plan. I love this quote. Here's a great cry and a little bull, the devil said in his short talks. He pivots to his own publications on medicines, the pharmacopoeia mentioned earlier, and highlights the accessibility to pharmaceuticals that's been central to all his works. The debate goes on, I won't go through the whole thing, but ultimately Sam makes the rhetorical shift that underscores his entire purpose, that the college itself is a confederacy of charlatans. Quote, I do not think any quack bill that was ever published can equal this of the Blue Book men. It is perfectly quacking all over. With all the hyperboles that the thing will admit of, he calls their work typical bedlam discourse. He stresses the point in a pretty rational way that the public cares very little about the college's magnanimous posturing when they cannot access a physician and they cannot pay for medicine. This polemic is anti-monopoly, anti-corporate, decidedly populist. And whether the pamphlet really sold or just gathered dust, we don't really know. It was for sale at just one shop, unusual for him. There's a complete absence of paratext. No preface to the reader, no picture of him. And his audience is pretty clear. He's speaking to his established readers, and he's explicitly reframing the College of Physicians as the quacks. Getting on, so I'll summarize here. The college did not take the charges lying down. In addition to the lawsuit, it responded by proxy with the help of a young surgeon named James Young. He lived down in Plymouth and became mayor of Plymouth at one point, and had this correspondence back and forth with some of the more established college physicians in London. And it seemed that he, in addition to being ambitious, you know, he had an eye for power. So he eventually was made deputy to the Surgeon General of the Navy, and he starts a correspondence. I don't have the smoking gun, but who
publishes Citrophel Vaculans, quack astrologer tossed in the market. And as you can see, it's an epistle to, I'm not going to say his name, but you know. The work is a classic screed of the period, going after Salmon for his inclusion of astrology and medicine, and that seems to be the real linchpin of this sort of debunking of Salmon. He's an astrologer. He didn't ever try to hide that. I mean, it runs through all his works. He puts it out there like he's exposing something nobody knew. And this Citrophel is interesting. It's the title character. It's a character in a mock heroic poem by Samuel Butler in the 1640s. It's written. This poem is really popular. It's got a knight errant named Sir Hudibras. And Sir Hudibras goes through a series of completely convoluted and implausible events and ends up at the home of Citrophel, who's an astrologer. Sir Hudibras may or may not have killed Citrophel, we don't know, but Citrophel gave him some kind of quack fake horoscope and things fell apart. And Young was really counting on his readers to know this. This is from Butler's piece, and the way he describes Citrophel is clearly what James Young is saying about William Salmon. Can't believe your crazy brain, without your soul. I love it. And the whole thing is really good. It's really about a medical person. Young's reference was clear to everyone at the time, and he's rewarded by the college. 2 years after he publishes this, he goes on a trip to London. The president of the Royal College, Thomas Holman, says, hey, come over for tea. He says, I love you. Goes for tea. There's three other physicians there, and Young writes this in his journal. They each ask me a question. What do you do if someone's red and hot and moist? How would you treat them? Oh, I don't know. Give them some dry leaves. And he gives his answer. He gives three answers. One of the three guys actually argues with him, but in the end, the other two say, stop arguing with him. And they hand him a license. He's a licentiate of the college on the spot. Quid pro quo. He doesn't even need a college license. Practices in Plymouth. He's not a limited physician. So they didn't really care what they were thinking. But the episode is tough. Clearly, by the end of the 17th century, Salmon had come to symbolize a real threat to the college. And Young's screed, drawing on the poem, points out how capably Salmon had used the press to advance his position. So let me finish up. Near the end of his life, Salmon issued a second edition of his translation of Symbol. In his preface, he recounted all the work he had brought to the public, highlighted what he thought were the 16 best works. At the top of his list is actually his herbal, which is fascinating. And the art of anatomy was last. But Salmon's really reflected here, considering not only the nature and use of his published works, but the medical hierarchy generally. And here's what he writes. There are a sort of men in the world who affect to be doctors, but are no physicians, who though they are great pretenders to our art, know so little truly of. To such persons as these, we do not address this work. These, by a kind of pedantry, triumph in their ignorance and folly. To the consideration of such, this work is not commended, because we know it is as much above their understandings as the author thereof is below their thoughts. He closes by suggesting that all the books he's published, while publicly condemned by these learned physicians, have secretly been read by them, proving at once the pedagogic value of the books and the hypocrisy of the learned men who pretend to hate them. Salmon is then, I think, a good example of the way print was used in early modern medicine to establish not just legitimacy, but authority. Frequently referred to as a quack, not only at the time, but even more recent scholarship. Salmon is a reminder of how careful we have to be in accepting these labels. His work undeniably contains elements that would be rejected by the medical establishment at the time, but it reflects in greater measure the skills of irregular physicians in London. By publishing works on a variety of medical topics, making those books accessible throughout the city, at some of the leading booksellers, if you go here, by the end of his career, his books are for sale in all of these bookshops in London. And I've only been able to kind of carve out my books, but the guy is all over the place. He's a common name. Salmon was able to shift the lines that demarcated quackery, pointing his accusing man salmon print